has become an all-consuming thing for me, and it's just music. You gotta love it. Kind of like you're floating in this emotion and trying to be a sponge and suck it up and feed it back. What we have realized is that we love making music together, and we're gonna do it no matter what. Minnesota. I think like most people grow up the same way. You sort of get exposed to pop radio when you're little. And I went to church camp where we sang songs and my mother can sing. And then there was this woman, I remember this woman at church when I was very young, and she would sing harmonies to everything. It was probably a huge help for me somehow, you know.
Keeps the kids off the streets, gives them something to do. Something to eat. This spot was a playground. This flat land used to be a town. Black gold in a white flag. Built to let's go and fly. Sure life to be a surprise. Which just makes me sad inside.
I was a trumpet player when I was a kid. I started playing trumpet in second grade, and I switched to saxophone in high school because I thought it was more of a rock and roll instrument. My older sister was a clarinet player, but what I really liked about going to my sister's concerts was the drummers. I used to pride myself on saying I started out playing the drums, just like Stevie Wonder and Frank Sinatra and Iggy Pop and Marvin Gaye. But other trumpet player brought Jimi Hendrix, Are You Experienced, to band practice one day. And then I just realized, why don't I just play electric guitar? And I'm kind of a jack of all trades, but I still am not very comfortable calling myself an awesome musician, but that's the rudiments.
Baby, and that I haven't met you yet. I hear you good, I hear you're made out of wood. Something wrong, they pull it straight.
was playing in a band, and Danny and Carl came and saw me at the historic Longhorn, which was like really cool rock and roll club when I was a kid in Minneapolis. It started out with me and Carl and Danny, and we were called Bore Me to Death. I was the drummer, and Carl and Danny were the two front guys, and that sort of became the birth of whatever it is now. Since those days of screaming, and all these years later, I've learned a lot about it. Even at the time, some of the most inspiring music to me were singers that did not sing in key at all. I mean, that was kind of the whole point. But I was also a fan of Leonard Cohen and Lou Reed and people that aren't Marvin Gaye. They don't have a beautiful voice, and that also gave me the confidence to be a singer. Well, there's a little man who can get his hands on a plant to sell the planet. Walks the walk, and he talks the talk. Half a crunch, you can have it. Every question, there are ways to shoot it down. Green backs, some green lights, some jets with wings to get this new thing off the ground. But I can't stand the gravity.
Summer breeze in the warm.
first break was playing at a club in Madison, Wisconsin, where my parents met, and we were playing with the Replacements. And Pete Jesperson was there, and he said, "I'm going to sign you to Twin Tone Records." And I just thought, oh, I made it. Because there was this little local record company in Minneapolis called Twin Tone, and all the cool local bands were on that label. And I just thought, if I can make it onto that label, I'm good. Here I am a few record labels later, but I think that was the first time I was like, man, all right, we're going to chase the dream or something, whatever it is. Once you draw the line, I can't think twice. And you would never take your own advice. You're skating on a grave that's paved with ice. Step into the light. How can I be sure if this is the sure thing? I fancy myself as a songwriter. Once I kind of figured out that I was never going to be as good a guitar player as Jimi Hendrix, I was like, how about the Ramones? And the Ramones really gave me my cue as far as like, this is really primitive and really simple and anyone can do it. And I think that's kind of a folk ethic that I really attached myself to. Music for the people, by the people, and it led me straight to Woody Guthrie and Bob Dylan and all these great writers, and they were kind of a lot about telling a story. And I think like 1 out of 10 songs should be a full-on narrative.
Say hello to my friend Carl Mueller. This one goes out to you, Carl.
The emotion of somebody dying, I didn't think it was going to happen to somebody that was my best friend, and I met him when he was 16. He got sick and then we were all just in denial. He was my moral center because he always had this great attitude about everything. There's this part of me that feels like I'm keeping him alive in my heart and dedicating him a song every night and keeping on with Soul Asylum. And his words to live by were always be nice. That tells you something about Carl. The song is about overcoming depression, but it's also acknowledging that it's real, and I think people identify with it in a real honest way because it's a little emotional. this video with a guy named Tony Kay, and he made a movie called American History X. He's incredibly creative and so visual that he's like, milk cartons. They have pictures of missing children on them. And he was just making a runaway train, runaway children sort of word analogy. So we ran with the idea and put these real kids in the video and tried to find them. And it turned into this kind of public service announcement. So the song is not about missing and exploited children, but it was associated with that. And I won a Grammy for Song of the Year. And I just gave it to my mom and I said, Mom, I hope you're proud of me. I got a trophy. But handing out awards for music seems a little odd to me. If that's what it takes to get me credibility, I got that.
One ticket for a runaway train. A madman laughing at the rain. I'll touch you insane. Just easier than dealing with the pain. Runaway train.
A broader canon of material now than we've ever had. Winston Roy is a New York musician who comes from the New School. I feel like it's sort of a privilege to play with Winston. And then we have Michael Bland, the greatest drummer in the world. He's played with Prince and he's played with all the great musicians from Minneapolis, and I love him. Justin is the new guy. And he grew up being a fan of the band. He walked in for his audition, and right after he walked out, me and Winston and Michael went, that's the guy, there he is. He's really fresh, and he brings an element to the band that's great because he honestly is enjoying himself. And as we grow up in rock and roll, we get jaded, you just do. I do as best I can, and I hope that we delivered on whatever their expectations might be. But really, what we're trying to do is blow people's minds, you know, and that's what I would like people to walk away with, a blown mind.